However, you have to remember that propofol can cause tongue fall and airway obstruction. So be aware of that. Remifentanil is a very good drug. It's excellent. It's got rapid onset, rapid offset. However, it is expensive and not very easily available in India. So more commonly, what we are using is now dexmedetomidine as a bolus for about 10 minutes followed by an infusion. It is an alpha-2 agonist and it has all sedative, analgesic and anxiolysis properties. It does not cause respiratory depression and it does not interfere with testing. It can be either used alone or in combination. Now, with these sedative drugs, don't forget that you should give some amount of analgesics to at least keep it ready. If there's any lacuna in your scalp block and the patient has pain, you can give additional analgesic in addition to the surgeon infiltrating locally. And this is especially during periosteum elevation or dural incision. Now, challenges of sedation is if there is surgery goes on for a very long time, there's inadequate sedation or inadequate analgesia, patients start becoming anxious, agitated. So you have to maintain a rapport, keep talking to the patient, comfort the patient, and if required, give additional analgesia. However, over-sedation can also cause airway compromise with the tongue fall, airway obstruction, hypoxia. So at any point of sedation, please be ready to convert to general anesthesia. Next comes the asleep, awake, asleep program. Okay, therefore, this strategy, we give general anesthesia with propofol and fentanyl. We can either maintain a total IV or put a supraglottic device or intubate the patient. After this, you do give a scalp block. Once the testing of peniotomy is done and you have to test, stop the sedation, awaken the patient, lighten the pain of anesthesia, hear the depth of anesthesia monitors do help. And once spontaneous ventilation is returned, tidal volume is good, patient is awake, you can remove the airway and then awaken up the patient so that the resection mapping, testing and resection of the tumor can be done. Again, at the end, after once we start closure, you can deepen the plane of sedation if required. Sometimes the patient maintains with even this, so you can have a modified asleep, awake, awake. However, if the patient is not very comfortable, you can deepen the plane of anesthesia and you can put a supraglottic airway. Advantages of this, of course, ability to control ventilation, you don't have any hypoxia, and at time when it is painful, like craniotomy, periosteum, elevation, etc., patient is more comfortable and under anesthesia. Now, we kept on talking about testing and mapping. So what exactly is this? Now, every patient who comes for a neurosurgery will have an MRI, so we know where the lesion is. Along with this, during awake craniotomies, we get something called a functional MRI done. Or an fMRI. Here, what we do is, you're in the MRI, the patient is asked to move his fingers, tongue, speech, legs, and then the functional tracts are noted. So during surgery, we see how close the tumor is to the functional tracts. And when you when the surgeon stimulates the cortical areas of interest, then the patient response is gauged. If you're doing motor, remember you check the contralateral side. That is, if you're doing a left-sided lesion, check the right-sided side, the hand, leg, check for the power, grip. Keep asking the patient to tell you if there's any weakness. That is the best monitor. Also check for any abdominal movements of the face, eyelids, tongue, any abnormal sensations. And if you're testing language like the Broca's and the Wernicke's area, you have to ask the patient to keep on talking. You ask questions, see what the answers are. You can repeat the questions. You don't see only word generation and sentences. You also see the comprehension. And if there's any language deficit or any speech arrest, you know you're too close to the speech area, basically. Okay. Now, for epilepsy surgery, along with all, we also do an electrocorticography. Now, what is electrocorticography? It is very similar to electroencephalography or EEG, but the electrodes, instead of being put on top of the scalp, the strip electrodes are put directly over the surface of the brain. Okay, and this is when the suspect areas are stimulated so that you can map the epileptic focus. However, we have to be, the procedure is the same like in conscious sedation. You stop the sedation or the general anesthesia 15 to 20 minutes before the EKG is done, and the surgeon will stimulate the areas. However, during this, the patient can have an intra-op seizure. So you have to be ready to stop the seizure. There should be ice poles aligned with the surgeon so they can irrigate and stop any further spread of seizure. We should have midazolam and propofol ready. You give 1 mg, start with 1 mg, you can give up to 5 mg, you can give boluses of 20 to 30 mg of propofol. Okay, at all the time during the seizure, please make sure you look at the airway. The patient doesn't have a tongue fall or a tongue bite, and you may need a chin lift, a jaw thrust, or intervention with an airway at this time. So, like, coming to complications, any procedure does have complications. We already spoke about the seizures, and also if it's a longer procedure and inadequate analgesia or inadequate sedation, patient can become agitated. Airway compromise can occur at any time. So to prevent hypoxia and hypercapnia, you can have to put in an airway device. Remember, at any point of time during this procedure, be ready to convert to general anesthesia. The patient's safety is of utmost importance. Also, don't forget that we've given a scalp block. So we have used a lot of local anesthetic. The surgeon also may be infiltrating some. So look out for local anesthesia toxicity. Postoperatively, most of our neurosurgical patients are monitored in the ICU for hemodynamic management, neurological monitoring. However, with awake craniotomies, we can lessen this admission to ICUs and only admit those patients who have significant medical comorbidities or surgical complications. We send, normally what we do is keep the patient in the post-op ICU anesthesia care unit for a longer time. If the patient's comfortable, they can even go to the inpatient ward. In few centers, especially in the Western countries, the patients are also done under daycare surgery. However, I think India has a long way to go before we step up to this. And therefore, to summarize, there's an increased use of awake craniotomy with evidence for improved survival with maximized lesion resection and minimum post-op neurological deficits. Remember, it's a team effort, so keep an open communication and collaboration with everybody in your OT, including the neurosurgeon and the neurologist. Patient is the most important factor to make sure the patient is comfortable. Pre-op counseling really helps for this. And there is no one best method, only scalp lock, asleep, awake, asleep. You have to tailor the anesthesia for every patient. Okay, so thank you. These are some references you can go to. So, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Swetal, for nicely delineating the considerations during the awake craniotomy. I think the important message is rapport between the surgeon, anesthetist, and the patient is paramount. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next speaker. Next, sorry, Dr. Yes. Misra, please.
Yes, yes.
And we'll have the questions after the...
Yes, yes.
All the papers.
Yes, yes. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm happy to be part of this very interesting ICA webinar on neuroanesthesia. Before I invite the second speaker, Dr. Manish Kohli, a bit of his introduction. Dr. Kohli, after joining, first joined Sarvangaram Hospital as a secondary DNB trainee, completed his DNB, did his senior residency, and joined as consultant anesthesiology. And Dr. Kohli has been associated with Sir Gangaram Hospital for about 9-10 years now. He has a special interest in acute and chronic pain. Also, he is interested in neurophysiological monitoring. Ultrasound-guided interventions are also his area of interest. He has had a training in fellowship in interventional pain management from Gangaram Hospital itself. He has had a Medtronic training program for yoke potential monitoring. He has written chapters in anesthesiology, written articles in national international journals. Now over to Dr. Manish Kohli, please. He will be speaking on neurophysiological monitoring during complex spinal surgeries. I hope and trust that he will also cover some of those less complex surgeries as what to do in those situations and where to avoid monitoring. Probably he will also talk about that. We'll listen to him first and then we'll go into question answers in the end. Over to Dr. Manish, please.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. The most common indications for the spine surgery are the trauma, infection, malignancy, be it intradural or extradural. But sometimes the patient also comes to us with some of the complex spine surgeries like the kyphoscoliosis and also some of the main degenerative diseases of the spine. For all these etiologies, primarily, the patient undergo a variety of instrumentation, the pedicle screw placements or the growing rod insertion, and so that we can correct the vertebral body alignment. And during this procedure, the spinal cord per se undergo a major destructive of the compressive forces, and there is a risk of major injury to the spinal cord. And adding on to the spinal cord injury, is the improper position of the patient during the surgical procedure. In order to monitor all these, or in order to monitor the spinal cord, we have to do the neurophysiological monitoring of the spinal cord intraoperatively, with the goals primarily of the continuous monitoring of the spinal cord activity, as well as for the early detection of neurological injury during surgical manipulation to allow for the countermeasures to change the outcome. The incidence of a neurological deficit post-surgery without IONM is 6.9% and with IONM is 0.5%. So in 1995 itself, the Scoliosis Research Society has emphasized on the use of intraoperative neurophysiological monitoring for the complex spine surgeries as well as for some lesions intradural. The anesthetic considerations remains the same, which can be divided into the patient-related or the comorbid conditions-related or disease-related or surgery-related. We will prefer total intravenous anesthesia to conduct all these surgeries under intraoperative, under neurophysiological monitoring. ASA standard monitors were applied to the patients, and we also use special monitoring techniques like the ankle clonal test, which were used earlier but not used nowadays, as well as a wake-up test and a special neurophysiological monitor intraop. The Segnara wake-up test 1973 is still a gold standard, I'll say. But the main problem is that the real-time analysis cannot be done with this technique. So, till date, we have done approximately 2,000 complex spine surgeries in our hospital, and out of them, 200 being the kyphal scoliosis surgeries. Since 2011 to date, we have the IONM monitor with us in our department, and all our experiences we have published in the Frontiers in Surgery in 2019. We are very well versed with the monitoring of the electrical activity of the heart, which is electrocardiogram, as well as the electrical activity of our brain, which is the EEG or the bispectral index. But we are quite skeptical about monitoring the electrical activity or the wiring of the brain and the spinal cord in continuum. In order to understand these SSEPs and MEPs, we just have to, to simplify these things, we just have to look into the two tracks, the sensory tracks as well as the motor tracks, or rather I will say the sensory wiring of the human body or the motor wiring of the human body. Looking into the sensory tracks, whenever a stimulus is applied in the peripheral sensory areas, the stimulus is transmitted via the spinocerebellar tract to the sensory cortex. And if we place a recorder or a receiver in the sensory cortex and record it, then we can get our SSEP or the somatosensory evoked response as an average electroencephalography. Similarly, whenever a stimulus is applied in the motor cortex area, the stimulus is transmitted in the motor tracts to the peripheral muscles. And the stimulus is received, or the response is received as a muscle contraction. And whenever there is a break in the integrity of the spinal or the motor tracts or the spinal cord, we are not able to elicit these MEPs or SSEPs. It's as simple as that. The somatosensory evoked potentials. In order to elicit the somatosensory evoked potential, approximately 200 to 300 stimuluses were applied over a period of 2 to 3 minutes at a given peripheral nerve. Commonly, ulnar and median nerve are used for stimulation for the upper spine, and tibial and peroneal nerve are used for the stimulation of the lower spine. And the responses are elicited either in the popliteal fossa or in the scalp. Commonly, scalp SSEPs are being used for monitoring the patients. In the previous studies, or previous meta-analysis comparing the different strategies of doing intraoperative neurophysiological monitoring, what they have observed in their observational studies, that the motor evoked potentials disappears much earlier than the somatosensory evoked potential whenever the surgeons are doing the distraction or spine surgeries. A probable answer to this lies in the structural anatomy and the blood supply of the spinal cord. The sensory tracts, which are posterior, are supplied by the posterior spinal arteries, which are paired. And it constitutes the 25% of the cord and has a very luxuriant flow. Whereas, contrary to it, the motor tracts, which are quite anterior, are supplied by a single anterior spinal artery and comprise of 75% of the cord. It has a very less flow and is a watershed area, especially in the thoracic spine. And hence, it is more prone to hyperperfusion injury. That is, the motor tracts are more prone to the hyperperfusion injury intraoperatively. And the main thing is the artery of the Adamkiewicz, which is quite notorious, which supplies approximately T9 to T10, which arise from the T9 to T10 of the reticular area. So it is advised that the combining the monitoring modalities like the SACPs or the motor evoked potential or the electromyography has a better results for diagnosing intraoperative catastrophe. Motor evoked potentials have a high sensitivity and a high specificity with a few false positives and negatives. To elicit the motor evoked potentials, an electrical stimulus is applied at the motor cortex area and the responses are elicited as a muscle contraction or a myogenic response in the peripheral muscles. In order to do a motor cortex monitoring, the electrical stimulus of 200 to 400 millivolts is applied at the motor cortex homunculus so that whole of the motor cortex is stimulated and the responses are elicited electrically at the level of epidural space or the nerve roots in a form of D wave, which is called the direct wave, followed by a I wave or the indirect wave. Or the responses can also be elicited in the peripheral nerves in the form of HF reflex. These responses can also be elicited as a myogenic or a muscle contraction response in the peripheral muscles. In some of the case scenarios, we are not able to stimulate the motor cortex. In those case scenarios, directly the spinal cord is stimulated epidurally because the spine is open with the help of a special probe. And suppose to elicit the motor evoked potentials or to get a response, and when the lesion is at primarily at the T10 or the L1 level, we will place our myogenic electrodes or the receiving electrodes at the myotomal supply of the T10 L1, as well as the myotomal supply of the sacral as well as the lower lumbar myotomes. So these needle electrodes are placed as a belly tendon method in the peripheral muscles. And these corkscrew electrodes are placed in the motor cortex area of the scalp to stimulate the motor cortex whenever a current is supplied and the myogenic response is elicited. And the placement of the electrode depends upon the spinal cord to be monitored, upon the level of the spinal cord that has to be monitored. A significant motor evoked potential change is a change which has complete loss of muscle contraction response in a lower spinal level with an intact responses in upper spinal level, or whenever there is a degradation of more than 75% in amplitude, or whenever there is a lack of evoked potential response, even after an increase in voltage to more than 100 volts above baseline. Evoked potentials are affected by factors that slow down the neural activity and conductance. The main being the pharmacological interventions like our anesthetics that slow down the metabolic rate and primarily the cortical responses. Certain physiological changes which can happen during surgery can also alter the evoked potential responses, like the ischemia or the hypoxemia or the hypotension and hypothermia. Apart from these things, surgical manipulations can also hamper the evoked potential responses, like the retraction, compression, or the clipping. In order to give our general anesthesia, definitely we should administer our various anesthetic adjuvants or anesthetic agents. Out of these, what we have seen that the benzodiazepines, the barbiturates, the nitrous oxide, and the inhalation anesthetic agents, they have a depressant effect on the evoked potential. Inhalation agents with nitrous oxide, especially of Mach more than 0.2 or 0.5, depresses the evoked potential responses. Whenever we are doing the myogenic response, the use of muscle relaxant will decrease the myogenic response, especially at tau of more than 2. Whereas when we do the somatosensory evoked potentials, the muscle relaxant doesn't have any effect. Therefore, for MEPs, the muscle relaxant are used only at the time of intubation and induction. The treatment of choice or the anesthesia of choice is total intravenous anesthesia with the help of opioids as well as propofol. Propofol can also cause decrease in the evoked potential response, but in the higher doses, not in the lower doses. Etomidate and ketamine can help because they decrease the threshold for generating the myogenic responses. And nowadays, dexmedetomidine is of help because it decreases the dose of propofol as well as opioid in the perioperative monitoring. This is one of our patients in which the myogenic, the MEPs have been applied. Here, the intubation is facilitated only with muscle relaxants and a high dose of propofol and fentanyl at the beginning of surgery. And the tube is fixed in the center of the mouth. And two bite blocks are placed in between the two molars bilaterally to avoid the bite at the muscle contraction. And the endotracheal tube is fixed with the incisors. This is our operation theater complex where we are doing the EMG responses, where we are checking the EMG responses as well as the motor evoked potential apart from a standard monitoring system. The infusions we use routinely are the propofol, dexmedetomidine, and the fentanyl infusions. The main thing which is of concern is that we avoid using or we avoid giving boluses in between the case. The common complications that can happen is the tongue laceration for which the bite block has already been placed, and also the cardiac arrhythmias and the scalp wounds. This is one of the motor evoked potential response, the report of the motor evoked potential response. In this, we can see that at the level of L2 and the L4, intraoperatively, we lose our evoked potential responses, but the evoked potentials are present at L5 and the S2 level. This simply means leads disconnection. So we need not to worry about. In another case, we are getting a response at 300 volts, the L5 and the S2 response, but with distraction and lengthening of the spine intraoperatively, the evoked potential response ceases to come, even after 100 volt increase in the stimulus. And with the release of the distraction or with easing out of the spine, again, the evoked potentials comes back immediately. Whenever there is a significant motor evoked potential change, so it's a collaborated effort between the surgeon, anesthesiologist, and the neurophysiologist. The surgeon at that particular time should stop the current manipulation. He should release the traction. He should check for the dura for compression. He should reverse the corrective maneuver and rod removal. He should confirm the stability of the spine and look for any implant malposition. We as anesthesiologists, it's our duty to check whether we have given any bolus of anesthesia drugs or muscle relaxant intraoperatively. We should lighten the plane or depth of anesthesia. We should reduce the MAC. We should reduce the IV anesthetic agents like propofol. We can increase the mean arterial pressures to more than 90 millimeters of mercury. At this time only, we should check for the oxygenation, tachycardia, hemoglobin drop, the acidosis, the temperature, and the input output. And we should check for the limb position. The neurophysiologist at this time should repeat check the motor evoked potential, should increase the strength of stimulus to get a response. And OT technicians should reduce the noise, should check for the should check for any electrical interference. Even if there is no improvement, then we can increase the mean arterial pressures to more than 100 millimeters of mercury or more. We should consider steroid administration. We should consider giving the calcium channel blockers, although they are controversial in use. And even if the response doesn't come, then our good old standard wake-up test comes to the rescue. This is the pedicle screw electromyography. For the spine fixation, the pedicle screws are being placed, but sometimes the pedicle screws lies in very close proximity to the nerve root. In order to avoid the injury, we use pedicle screw electromyography to avoid injury to the nerve roots. Some of the contraindications are epilepsy, intracranial vascular clips, cortical lesions, cardiac arrhythmias, cardiac pacemakers, and unexplained intraoperative seizures. We should abolish our MEP response elicitation. Whenever the lesion is above...
Dr. Manish, time please.
So this is the last slide. But that's it. Thank you. Whenever the lesion is above the level of C4, or whenever there is a risk of the vertebral artery injury, we should take the help of our auditory evoked potentials. It's a near time, but it's a good technique and it can make a difference. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Manish Kohli. And at the outset, I'd like to congratulate the Indian College of Anesthesiologists for this initiative in showcasing the talent of the young neuroanesthetists. And I welcome the next speaker. It is a pleasure to welcome the next speaker, Dr. Sumit Kalra, who was my fellow in 2013. Now he's an associate consultant at Sir Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi. His areas of interest are neuroanesthesia, the use of ultrasound in anesthesia and trauma anesthesia as well. And he'll be speaking on a very current topic, that is optic nerve sheath diameter and its use in neuroanesthesia and beyond. Over to Dr. Sumit Kalra. Dr. Sumit?
Am I audible, sir? I'm so sorry.
Yes.
Am I audible now?
Yes, but I can't see your slides. Yeah.
Can see now, sir?
Yes.
Yep. Thank you, sir, for the kind introduction. I bring greetings from Sir Gangaram Hospital. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizers of the ICA program for giving me this opportunity. Optic nerve sheath diameter of all the non-invasive methods to assess the intracranial pressure, ultrasonographic ONSD assessment has a very good correlation with ICP. It has been proven in many studies, and it has the advantages of portability of equipment, being able to rapidly perform, and has a very short learning curve, literally low cost, and has avoidance of ionizing radiation associated with CT scans and avoidance of patient transport for imaging. The basic anatomy of the optic nerve is surrounded by a leptomeningeal sheath within which is contained the subarachnoid space with CSF. The intraorbital subarachnoid space is in direct communication with the brain. The anterior part of the optic nerve is loosely attached to the dural sheath and is only surrounded by orbital fat, thus making it distensible. The maximum sheath distension occurs at around 3 millimeters behind the papilla. And whenever there is a rise in ICP, the CSF is pushed towards this narrow rim of CSF between the optic nerve and the optic sheath, causing its expansion. This expansion can be visualized via ultrasound like this, 3 millimeters behind the papilla. We'll come to the calculations later on. The subarachnoid space of the human optic nerve is not a homogeneous empty chamber filled with CSF. It is made up of complex arachnoid tubercle and septa system. ONSD, they vary from patient to patient and also vary in different locations of the sheath. This is an electron microscope diagram showing arrows of various septa and tubercle in the optic nerve, the subarachnoid space around the optic nerve. And this is along the whole optic nerve, the various cross sections at which the anatomical structure, how much it varies with the within the same optic nerve in the same patient. We would like to give a very, very important part to the basic principles of ultrasonography, because the primary aim is to do no harm first. So we have to know about the precautions to be taken before we do the scan. High frequency probe is of low penetration and is the most commonly available probe for superficial structures, and it should be used. Here in the picture, you can see the probe. This is the linear probe and this is the hockey stick probe. Both have the frequencies here mentioned on them. The preset should be nerves or small parts. And some machines do come with the ocular preset. A LARA principle of ultrasonic instrumentation should be used. One should be definitely aware of mechanical index, which is a relative potential of the ultrasound to create a non-thermal bio effect, and thermal index, which is an indicator of relative potential for tissue temperature rise. These are mostly mentioned on the top right corner, where the frequency and the mode of the ultrasound machine is mentioned. Like here, it is mentioned here. small parts and this thing. Ergonomics is of prime importance when you when doing a scan. The operator, the scanning area, and the machine should be in one line of vision. The patient, supine, with the examiner at the head end. There should be no physical pressure on the globe and should be minimal adequate lighting in the room or ICU to get a good image. This was a patient who came to a hospital for an intracranial hemorrhage and had an EVD done. And this is my senior doing a optic nerve sheath examination. And he had the option of both the probes, whichever he could get a good image from. We'll show you the video of this patient's ONSD. Tegaderm and jelly are of cornerstone importance because they protect the eye, one. Secondly, while applying Tegaderm, the important thing to note is there should be no air bubble around the area because that will cause lead to artifact. And copious amount of jelly, it should be used to bring about to facilitate a very good image acquisition. Various views have been defined for ultrasound and transverse, sagittal, and inferior coronal view are the most commonly used. These are both the probes we have at our setup, the hockey stick ones and the linear probe. And one has to just start doing ultrasound and then get used to getting an optimized image. And coming to the scan part, all parameters such as time gain compensation, depth gain are individually adapted in order to achieve the best image quality. This is how it looks like. This was recently done for a patient at a hospital. The MI, the mechanical index and thermal index are mentioned within limits. It is a linear probe and the nerves of small parts preset has been set. This is the anterior chamber, the lens and the vitreous appears homogeneously anechoic and the optic nerve, it appears as a well-defined longitudinal compact structure. In an awake patient for the best results, we ask the patient to look forward if standing or look up if supine. Coming to the breakup of the sono anatomy, for the PGs, they should not be hesitant to do a scan. One should understand that this should be a black, white kind of a picture they will achieve. In medical terms, it is called as for optic nerve fiber, it is a hypoechoic central layer, followed by a pyometer, which is a hyperechoic layer. Then the CSF, which is again hypoechoic, and dura mater, which is hyperechoic. So ONSD is measured as the space within the dura mater on opposite side of the sheaths. ONSD scan, the measurement is done 3 millimeter behind the vitreoretinal junction. If you just pay attention here on the screen, you can have a look that this is the 3 millimeter measurement which has been done. Okay. And after that, it is done at the perpendicular to the optic nerve axis. And the mean value of three measured values taken in 2 to 3 views for the exact to rule out any artifacts or any measurement errors. This is the gap between them is the optic nerve diameter, whereas this gap is the optic nerve sheath diameter. There is a vigilant training, which is advised, the learning curve as per studies for experience and all, this is about 10 examinations. And for a novice, it is about 25. There has been a matter of debate as to the optimal cutoff value for the detect elevated ICP. The range as per the studies is between 4.9 to 6.2 millimeters. The likely cause of this variation is the anatomical variation and all the measurement protocol differences between the studies or measurement errors or the variability in various different pathological conditions. The mean value for optic nerve sheath diameter among patients who, which are with the diagnosed increased ICP in a recent meta-analysis was given as 5.82 millimeters. This was a scan which was recently done at a patient which came to us for acute SDH. So you can have a look here. This is the one measurement and this is the two. And you can see the values here. It is taken at 3 millimeter and this ONSD value is 0.67. Going away from the absolute numbers, trend is more important than cutoff value for ONSD. And following up of ONSD in the same patient over time, instead of having a fixed threshold value is of more importance because sometimes in some normal patients also, we see such high values. There have been much more interest in further evaluation and further measurements which we could do with the ONSD scan. The optic nerve sheath diameter by eyeball transverse diameter ratio, ETD ratio, and optic nerve sheath diameter inside and including and excluding the dura, the retinal artery Doppler, the difference between ONSD and OND are the new measurements which are being evaluated in various studies. This ratio is a reliable indicator of raised ICP, and in some studies it has been proven to be even more valuable. Normal value is about 0.18. This is the video I was talking about. If you can have a look, this is the papilledema edema. You can see this is a corroborative picture of papilledema. To confirm that this is the papilla, we started doing a color Doppler, and we could see the retinal artery also pulsating with it. There are still certain limitations for this ONSD measurement. There's a lack of uniform cutoff value. It is operator dependent. There's a potential risk for pressure injury to the globe, and there's a false positive in certain ocular pathologies like ocular nerve sheath meningiomas, some leukemic infiltration, Graves' ophthalmopathy, and acoustic shadow artifact from the lamina cadrosa. There's definitely a learning curve. Best view is controversial, so an average of use is taken. It doesn't give a blank yes or no, black and white picture like POCUS or EFAST. And there's always a degree of uncertainty. It is inevitable with the measurements at millimeter level. The clinical applications in neurological circumstances, this has been given a diagnostic accuracy of 100% for cerebral hemorrhage in some studies. In subarachnoid hemorrhage, the increase in ONSD is persistent despite normalization of ICP. And there's a postulated impaired retraction capability of optic nerve sheath after a massive ICP exposure. So readings may be unreliable in subarachnoid hemorrhage. In stroke, has a role in both early diagnosis of stroke complication as well as in follow-up of thrombolytic therapy's effectiveness. In idiopathic intracranial hypertension, it has a role in both diagnosis as well as follow-up with the treatment, even in the emergency department. In hydrocephalus, there is a role as a measure of surgical outcome. It can evaluate shunt malfunction. It can also screen patients depending upon the dynamic variability for shunt intervention in idiopathic normal pressure hydrocephalus. It has a role in symptomatic intracranial hypotension or the post-lumbar puncture headache or PTPH as we most commonly encounter in the general anesthesia practice. In this, the scan is done both in supine position as well as in standing position. And there is a gross decrease in the optic nerve sheath diameter from supine to standing. There's a diagnostic, it is a significant diagnostic value in intracranial hypertension cases. And even the response to treatment can be judged. Why? Because after giving an epidural blood patch, there's an increase in the optic nerve sheath diameter, which can be seen. In ICU, there's a potential role in early weaning phase from the invasive ICP monitoring. In pediatric ICU, it can be used to detect the raised ICP. ONSD can also predict neurological outcomes in post-cardiac arrest patients. In the patients with acute liver failure, a higher ONSD was associated with a higher hospital mortality. Other important application is that it can be used as a diagnostic tool for optic patis, in which patient will have unilateral significant optic nerve thickening. You can see this in this image. This is the affected eye, and this is the normal eye, which is having the normal optic nerve sheath diameter, and there the diameter is high. In severe preeclampsia also, it was associated with significantly higher optic nerve sheath diameter and increased optic disc height. Other much studied but debatable role applications are Press syndrome, in which it may transorbital sonography may be used for demonstrating papilledema. In meningitis and encephalitis, the pathophysiology is complex and the role is debatable. There is much interest in its role in acute mountain sickness. Multiple studies have been done, but it has been postulated that ICP does have a role in acute mountain sickness. It does, ONSD does increase with altitude, but the pathophysiology is under investigation and the role debatable. It appears to be a promising tool because of the portability of the ultrasound now. Intraoperative applications, it acts as an intraoperatively ICP monitoring surrogate. It is very commonly used nowadays in laparoscopic surgeries and robotic surgeries where CO2 pneumoperitoneum concomitant with steep head down position can cause a raised ICP. And to monitor ICP in prone position, and during procedures requiring neck extension. A recently conducted trial on percutaneous tracheostomy concluded that the ICP raised to dangerous detrimental limbs during the procedure. In the post-op period, there are very, very less studies, but the studies point towards a relation between optic nerve sheath diameter decrease and post-op cognitive dysfunction. Whereas the other study has found a relation between extracorporeal life support time and ONSD 24 hours after surgery in open cardiac surgeries. Future perspectives, artificial intelligence-based algorithms are being evaluated. This was a very, very good study in which they did a AI-based algorithm where they, after achieving the images processed both by the attending physicians as well as AI-based protocol. And this AI-based protocol had calculated the ONSD reliably and with very high precision. So they have been very much interest as to the road ahead and where do we go from here or the next steps. So the next steps needed are the standards for image acquisition technique should be established and the points to grade the quality of image. There should be studies comparing the ONSD-based treatment regimes with the standard treatment to determine if the optic nerve sheath ultrasound results in improvement of meaningful clinical outcomes or not. And the future research should also focus on defining the threshold of definition of raised ICP via ONSD and on the behavior of ONSD with increasing ICP, especially in conditions like subarachnoid hemorrhage and traumatic brain injury. Before conclusion, I would like to just say this picture, this is a search result from the PubMed, optic nerve sheath diameter ultrasound. The recent growing interest in the studies in the last decade. And I would like to say that invasive ICP monitoring as a research tool was introduced in 1951. It remained a research tool for almost four decades until it got widespread acceptance when it got incorporated into the Brain Trauma Foundation guidelines in 1995. So ONSD has enormous potential and the growing interest in ONSD research. It is presumably on the same path as an invasive ICP monitor, and we will soon have standards after some more research is happening. In the end, as of for all the monitoring devices, understanding limitations and defining realistic clinical application are crucial for a correct use of ONSD evaluation. Thank you for your patient listening. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Sumit. And I hand over to Dr. Rachna Bhutani to introduce the next speaker.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, everyone. I would like to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Ankur Luthra. He is Associate Professor, Department of Anesthesia and Intensive Care at Postgraduate Institute of Medical Education and Research, Chandigarh. His areas of interest are neuroanesthesia and neurocritical care, pediatric and trauma care, and difficult airway scenarios. He has many publications, 65 international and national publications, including 14 international book chapters. He would be speaking on rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis, anesthetic implications, and management. Dr. Ankur, please.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Yeah. So my topic for today is rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis and its anesthetic implications. And at the very outset, I would like to thank the Indian College of Anesthesiologists, Professor Jayashree, and all my respected teachers for giving me this opportunity to speak in front of you. Now, mucormycosis previously was called zygomycosis. It was an uncommon life-threatening fungal infection. Now, remember when I say uncommon, it was uncommon in the pre-COVID era. In the post-COVID, especially before and after the second wave of COVID, it has become an epidemic in India, especially the Indian subcontinent. And it's seen mostly in patients who have uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, who are immunocompromised, and have those patients who have fought the ICU cares of the post-COVID status. And we'll be talking about more in detail further as we proceed. It's an acute granulomatous and opportunistic infection, which has an intrinsic ability to invade the blood vessels and cause a blackish necrotic ischemic eschar formation. And that's why it has been falsely labeled as black fungus. Actually, the newspapers, the media, they have falsely labeled it as black fungus mucormycosis is not black fungus. Black fungus is something which is an yeast which has melanin in its walls. But because it causes a blackish HR formation, for layman, mucormycosis has been labeled as black fungus. And cerebrorhino-orbital mucormycosis is the most common form and the most aggressive form of mucormycosis. Now, etiologically, it has been mainly caused by the rhizopus, or the mucor, or the rhizomucor species. And the major risk factors include uncontrolled diabetes, that is, in 80 to 90% cases of rhinocerebral mucormycosis, it occurs in DKA or diabetic ketoacidosis patients. In others, like deferoxamine therapy, mostly in post-COVID cases, those who have been on unscrupulous doses of steroids for longer durations, immunosuppressants, anti-cancer medications, hematological malignancies, AIDS patients, protein energy malnutrition, severe neutropenic patients, it has been also seen as debilitating form of mucor. And I've told you that the rhinocerebral form has a very high mortality, up to 88%. The other forms include pulmonary mucormycosis, cutaneous, gastrointestinal, disseminated forms, and isolated renal mucormycosis. Now, the pathogenesis includes it's an opportunistic infection which causes invasion of the major blood vessels, causing necrosis and infarction of the contagious tissues, leading to a black eschar. Ketoacidosis, hyperglycemia, and hypoxia are excellent growth condition for the growth of this fungus. And ketoacidosis also decreases inflammatory responses and delays local aggregation of granulocytes and fibroblasts, which leads to florid sepsis by mucormycosis. Now, what happened after COVID-19? Initially, after the first wave, the landmark trial, which was published in the New England Journal of Medicine, which was the recovery trial, said that dexamethasone has been very helpful in moderate to severe patients of COVID-19 to suppress the cytokine storm. This particular journal and this particular article gave a license, especially in the Indian subcontinent and even in other countries, to use this corticosteroids. And some have been using it so unscrupulously that as high as 7 grams of methylprednisolone have been given to patients for, say, duration of more than 3 weeks. And such immunosuppression, though, has suppressed the cytokine storm, but has led to another epidemic, that is of mucormycosis. So this post-COVID sepsis immunosuppression, plus even those patients who battled the cytokine storm and the use of tocilizumab or the itolizumab and other such immunosuppressants, led to development of florid mucormycosis as early as even the second or the pro-inflammatory phase of COVID-19. Even in diabetic patients or those who were earlier not diabetics became glucose intolerant, I mean, became insulin-dependent diabetes, they developed, and they were prone to ketoacidosis, and which also helped mucor to grow in these patients. Plus, happy hypoxia due to COVID-19, as we all know, has led to its unscrupulous growth. With increased ferritin has also helped mucor to grow. And of course, in Indian subcontinent, even the use of industrial oxygen and contaminated humidifiers, which have been used in our country, have led to development of mucormycosis and from its spores in these patients. Now, the clinical manifestations that developed are unilateral headache behind the eye, facial pain, proptosis, redness, visual disturbances, diplopia. Necrotic lesions were found on the hard palate or the nasal mucosa with nasal congestion, blackish discharge, sinusitis, epistaxis, and the patient developed fever in the pro-inflammatory phase post-COVID-19. In signs, there was ulceration, there was necrosis, there was discharge, and black eschar formation on the palate in the oral cavity. There was tenderness in the cheekbone, and there was superior orbital apex syndrome, that was redness, proptosis, ophthalmoplegia, with a cherry red spot on the fundoscopic examination. These patients developed, leading on to central retinal artery occlusion and complete blindness. Now, these were some of my patients who developed blackish eschar, especially on the maxillary region, as you can see, with a lot of proptosis, chemosis, nasal and oral edema. And this was a 7-year-old child who developed, again, proptosis and diplopia, and he's developing left superior orbital fissure syndrome. So how did it start? It was basically from the nasal mucosa and sinuses. The infection went on to involve the orbit, leading on to orbital apex, superior orbital fissure syndrome, and finally a stage 3 of cerebral involvement, in which the intracranial spread occurs via the ophthalmic artery, superior orbital fissure, or the cribriform plate, which includes cavernous sinus thrombosis, even the superior sagittal sinus thrombosis, the ophthalmic artery involvement, frontal abscesses, and diffuse hematogenous spread. Diagnosis was histopathologically, we aimed at finding out the agents of mucormycosis with a non-septate hyphae with right angle branching. And it was diagnosed to be on the cerebral involvement by a contrast-enhanced MRI and a CT scan to detect fungal angioinvasion, bony destruction and necrosis with soft tissue involvement and intracranial involvement. And the contrast-enhanced MRI provided a good delineation of sinus involvement and angioinvasion. So this was one of the CT scans of patients with left maxillary, and in the right is the ethmoidal sinuses with scattered high density areas in patients with mucormycosis. The management begins with, as soon as you diagnose this, you start the patients on antifungal therapy with a liposomal amphotericin B of 5 mg per kg per day and in cerebral involvement up to 10 mg per kg per day, along with the routine routine amphotericin B deoxycholate in a dose of 1 mg per kg per day. When it became non-available, the other antifungals like posaconazole or isavuconazole were also used. And surgery with early surgical intervention was associated with improved survival. You have to debride all the necrotic tissue and excision of the infected brain tissue, which is required. And revision surgeries may also be required, along with strict diabetic control. And some patients were also relieved by hyperbaric oxygen therapy. Now, diabetic ketoacidosis management, as you all know, is very, very common. And this has been the emergency management or optimization of patient with who's come to you with uncontrolled sugars. You'd get serum electrolytes, you see the sugar ABG, you look at the pH, you start giving them lots of fluids with 0.9% saline over the first 1 to 3 hours, followed by then 0.45% saline at about 150 to 300 mils per hour. And then you can change it to dextrose insulin and start insulin with 0.1 units per kg IV and then continue by infusions. And you can increase up to as high as 2 to 3 folds if there is no response seen within the first 2 to 4 hours. And you have to continuously monitor serum potassium. The surgery which has to be taken up is craniotomy excision of the various abscesses. Other surgeries include FES, turbinectomies, palatectomies, orbital excentrations, enucleations, maxillectomies, and redo debridements. These were very extensive form of surgeries. So as far as the anesthetic considerations for these surgeries include, the first, because it's a mutilating surgery and involves the airway, the nasal cavity, even the upper airway, so difficult airway comes in the first part of the anesthesiologist to handle. Then, of course, the challenges with other challenges which the anesthesiologist has to bear are uncontrolled or poorly controlled diabetes mellitus, fluid electrolyte imbalances. And the patients came in post-COVID pro-inflammatory phase with a lot of cytokine storm, very sick patients, steroids, immunosuppressants, and they were also on anticoagulants. So you have to bridge them. Then hemodynamic instability because of underlying septicemia, amphotericin B, which was started in these patients through central lines, leading on to renal dysfunctions. And you have to be very careful with amphotericin B related side effects. Then bleeding, avascular necrosis, coagulopathy, and these patients came on to redo surgeries. So all these became important anesthetic considerations. So for PAC checkup, you have to know the COVID status of the patients, whether he was, how much oxygen was required, whether he was admitted in ICU, how long he was mechanically ventilated, whether tracheostomized, HRCT chest for any inflammatory phase of the in the lungs or the interstitial fibrosis that developed in the lungs, with comorbidity control, sugar control, HbA1c values, fluid electrolyte status because they developed hypokalemia, hypomagnesemia, the cardiac status, post-COVID myocarditis, cardiomyopathy, so low ejection fractions in these patients, that was very challenging for anesthesiologists. Patients on anticoagulant, subcutaneous heparin, oral heparin, low molecular weight heparin, how to bridge, how to stop, when to stop, all these were important things to be managed. Effects of amphotericin B per se, renal dysfunction, creatinine, rising creatinine, concomitant antibiotics, sepsis control. So the investigations included complete CBC, electrolytes, sugar, HbA1c, RFT, LFT, ketones, x-rays, CT scans, 2D echo, very important, coagulation profile, a CT MRI of the orbit, paranasal sinuses in brain, ABG for sick patients, and blood typing cross-matching with thromboelastography for controlling and looking at what blood products would be required to the patient, and definitely RT-PCR. If they were positive, they were treated in COVID-positive OTs, otherwise in the COVID-negative ENT areas. Induction and intubation, of course, preparing for difficult airway, very, very important, difficult mask ventilation, difficult laryngoscopy in these patients because of their diabetes, long-standing or restricted mouth opening because of pain, oroantral and palatal fistulas, a lot of supraglottic edema, epiglottitis, oro and nasopharyngeal obstruction. So you have to be careful and you have to be ready with fiberscopes, CMAC video laryngoscopes, short size tubes, all size of the blades and airways, LMAs, intubating bougies, stillets, etc. Everything to be ready as far as difficult airway is concerned. For intubation, rapid sequence intubation preferable because you want to avoid desaturation in these patients. Pre-oxygenate for a good 3 to 5 minutes. Succinylcholine can be used despite that they may have features of raised IgP due to cerebral abscess, but whenever the chance for difficult airway comes, airway takes on priority. CMAC video laryngoscope was the most preferred agent for helpful for these patients. Small size flexometallic and armored ETT is used because the airways become shared with the surgeons. Throat packing is a must after ETT, and you have to handle the tissues very, very carefully in the palatal areas and the nasal areas, because there are a lot of fragile areas that bleed easily, and Ryle's tube can be inserted by the surgeon towards the end of the procedure. Now, as far as the basic management is concerned, two large bore IV access is must. CVC line, usually, because these patients on long-standing antifungal, especially amphotericin B. Also, you have to avoid IGV, so you can prefer subclavian and femoral access in these patients, because you don't want to put a central line in an area which is near to the abscess or near to the oroantral or the palatal fistulas or the neck area. Then arterial line is again must because of the hemodynamic instability, frequent ABG, blood glucose, electrolytes monitoring, TEG monitoring, thromboelastography, and of course the neuromuscular monitoring, because of the concomitant hypomagnesemia and the hypokalemia. The neuromuscular blockers have to be titrated to a very good TOF value, and you have to be very careful with that. Then maintenance, of course, isoflurane has been said to be fungistatic agent, so it's been used. And propofol infusion can also be used in case you're anticipating raised ICP and a lot of big cerebral abscess. Then bleeding, venous air embolism, post-craniotomy, and definitely steroid-induced adrenal suppression, because these patients have been on unscrupulous high doses of steroids. So adrenal suppression can occur and they'll be landing up in hypotension. So stress dose of steroids need to be administered before. As far as the drug interactions are concerned, if the patients have been on HCQ, ondansetron has to be carefully administered because they may lead on to prolonged QT syndromes. With amphotericin B-related side effects like muscle spasm, phlebitis, hypotension, thrombocytopenias, encephalopathy, respiratory stridor, fever, chills, and anaphylaxis are very, very common with these amphotericin B. So all these, and of course, nephrotoxicity is very, very important and has to be taken care of. And if there is venous air embolism post-craniotomy, you have to inform the surgeon immediately, stop nitrous, switch to 100% oxygen, flush the field with normal saline, modify your anesthetic technique, switch over to TEVA and stop inhalational agents, aspirate from the central venous axis, which you have, provide jugular compression, maintain hemodynamics, and if possible, change the position of the patient so that airlock does not stays in the right ventricle, does not go into the pulmonary circulation. And as far as the extubation and post-op course is concerned, do not extubate these patients if you think there has been an extensive cerebral surgery with lots of bleeding or episodes of venous air embolism. If there's a lot of cosmetic disfigurement, flap surgeries, redo surgeries, or in short interval, you might have another surgery, lots of airway edema, epiglottitis, supraglottic edema. If there is need for repeated debridements, if there is other causes like hypothermia, hypokalemia, hypocalcemia, or prolonged neuromuscular blocking effects, delayed awakening, or the even non-convulsive status epilepticus has been reported in during cerebral abscess surgeries for these patients, or if there has been massive transfusion, bleeding, septicemia, or the patients are in shock. Once you plan to extubate, remove throat back just before extubation. And you can even plan an early tracheostomy for weaning these patients if you think the patients are going to have a repeated flap surgeries or lots of upper airway edema is there. For post-op analgesia, you have to take care with fentanyl and tramadol. Avoid NSAIDs as far as possible because there's already concomitant renotoxicity due to undergoing, there's amphotericin B induced nephrotoxicity. And you have to control blood sugars, continue antifungals for at least 4 to 6 weeks, and continue antibiotics to prevent septicemia. And there can be complications like of neurological deficits, blindness, cerebral internal carotid artery thrombosis, infarction, stroke, anosmia with loss of sense of smell, cavernous sinus thrombosis, superior sagittal sinus thrombosis, and internal carotid artery thrombosis. In the end, I would just like to summarize by saying that pre-op assessment of these patients is very, very crucial, and you have to inculcate a protocol-based strategy that is called MUCA, with anesthesia management extremely, extremely critical. And you have to take care of the airway, the blood sugars, bleeding tendencies, air embolisms, amphotericin B-related side effects, multiple comorbidities, cardiomyopathies, diabetes, and electrolyte management. All this becomes very, very challenging for an anesthesiologist. So thank you very much, and greetings from PGI Chandigarh once again. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Ankur. And I would like to request Dr. Joseph to take over, please.
Yeah. It is my pleasure to introduce the next speaker, Dr. Ankur Khandelwal. He's a very dynamic, extremely well-trained and qualified neuroanesthesiologist. He has done his PDCC from SGPGI Lucknow and has also done his DM from AIIMS. He's extremely involved in academics, and he's got more than 50 PubMed Index Journal publications, and some chapter publications as well. And he's now currently a consultant in neurosciences at Sharda University, Greater Noida. I welcome Dr. Ankur, Dr. Khandelwal to speak on perioperative neuroprotection strategies. Over to Dr. Khandelwal.
Thank you so much, sir, for the introduction, and a very good evening to all my teachers and colleagues. And the residents attending this webinar, giving and be a part of this webinar. So my topic is perioperative neuroprotection strategies, and greetings from Sharda Hospital, which is a super specialty hospital in Greater Noida. So the topic is an area where more than 200 trials have been done in experimental laboratory animals with very good results. However, the same has not been replicated in humans, and that is where the current evidence is lacking. So perioperative brain injury depends on multifactorial causes. What brain Doctor, requires...
Sorry, are you sharing a screen? Please share your screen.
Is it visible, sir?
Yes, now.
This is the first slide, sir.
Yeah, okay.
So the brain requires a continuous supply of oxygen and glucose, and there is a well-managed flow metabolism coupling. The cerebral blood flow in adults is around about 50 to 55 ml per 100 gram per minute of brain tissue, and metabolism runs in a flow of 3 to 3.5 ml per 100 gram per minute. So this matching is well done. However, when there is mismatch in flow metabolism or there is deprivation of oxygen and glucose supply, there can be brain injury. And independent risk factors are advanced age, previous cerebrovascular disorders, and renal failure, even though there are many other factors which leads to perioperative brain injury, but these are independent risk factors. Highest incidence is usually quoted as 1 to 3 days after surgery, and the various multifactorial presentations can be postoperative cognitive dysfunctions. It can be delirium, it can be latent or the covert strokes, and it can be sometimes malignant strokes in the postoperative period. So what is the concern? The concern is it increases mortality, it lengthens hospitalization, impairs postoperative quality of life, and increases perioperative costs. So this is how the cascade runs whenever there is a perioperative brain injury. In the immediate period, within minutes to hours, there is severe excitotoxicity, which leads to neuronal depolarization. It leads to presynaptic release of glutamates and aspartates. There is widespread intracellular excitation of calcium ions, and there is generation of free radicals. Thereafter, within hours to days, there is severe inflammatory process causing release of various inflammatory markers such as interleukins and adhesion molecules, which are toxic to neuronal structures. And thereafter, within days to weeks, there is another process which is apoptosis caused by various other enzymes, particularly endonucleases and caspases. So what is actually neuroprotection? So neuroprotection is defined as any strategy that antagonizes, interrupts, or slows the sequence of injurious biochemical and molecular events which have the potential to cause irreversible cell death. So various neuroprotective strategies have been basically postulated on various factors. The initial was that suppression of metabolic suppression theories, that is, most of the anesthetic drugs in the experimental models were tried based on the fact that they used to suppress the cerebral metabolic rate of oxygen consumption and thereby provide neuroprotection. Thereafter, many other strategies were applied, like preconditioning and post-conditioning, in which not only anesthetic drugs but non-anesthetic drugs also came into play. So this is a schematic representation as to there can be non-pharmacological measures for neuroprotection, as well as there can be pharmacological protections for neuroprotection. Pharmacological can again be divided into anesthetic agents, non-anesthetic agents. And as we see in the chart, innumerable number of agents have been tried in experimental models such as NMDA receptor antagonist, calcium channel blockers, sodium channel blockers, free radical scavengers, the glucocorticoids, the erythropoietin, the statins, and many other drugs have been tried, and they have been very successful as far as laboratory animals were considered. And the various mechanisms of neuroprotection that have been cited in literature includes anti-inflammatory activity, antioxidant, anti-excitotoxic, anti-apoptotic, free radical scavenging property, stabilization of blood-brain barrier, reducing catecholamine surge, inhibiting cortical spreading depolarization, and inducing neurogenesis and angiogenesis. But the recent concept again has invited many non-anesthetic drugs to come into play, even though anesthetic drugs have also been applied for cerebral preconditioning. It is a phenomenon in which the brain protects itself against noxious injury, against various injury by adapting to low doses of noxious stimuli. So what we do here is that we provide short ischemic episodes which are subfatals to cells and allow the body to protect by protecting endogenous mechanisms. And why do we do it? We do it because we want to stimulate the endogenous mechanisms of protection. And these are the various preconditioning stimuli that have been tried in various studies. Most of them, again, are experimental models like inducing transient global and focal ischemias, brief periods of hypoxemias, cortical spreading depolarizations, brief periods of seizures, exposure to inhalants, and so on. The list is very exhaustive, and they have been tried as a preconditioning stimuli to stimulate endogenous production of antibodies. But the question now arises, so many, more than 200 trials have been done in experimental models, and are we capable enough to replicate this bedside practice to bedside? The question is again, no. There have been two beautiful editorials which were published in JNA and Anesthesiology in 2019 and way back in 2017. There is a big question mark that anesthetic are neuroprotectants, still doubtful. It was again a very comprehensive review which was published in BJ in 2013, and it was done by Bilotta et al, where they included 25 RCTs, of which 22 RCTs were patients involving cardiac surgeries. More than 3,200 patients were involved in this review, and as we can see, there is an exhaustive list of the drugs which were tried, and the results were only one study RCT showed that atorvastatin, and one RCT showed that magnesium sulfate is associated with post-operative lower incidence of post-operative neurological deaths, whereas 24 RCTs did not show any difference with any drug as far as post-operative cognitive dysfunction was concerned, and none of the tested drugs was associated with a reduction in mortality. So it failed in providing evidence as far as humans are concerned. Yes, but in this review, dexmedetomidine was not concerned, and we are now coming up with more latest reviews. Dexmedetomidine as a neuroprotection, the mechanism is by activation of alpha-2 adrenergic receptors, which in turn inhibits inflammation and decreases the sympathetic activity. At the same time, it reduces the neuroexcitatory markers. So there was a review published in Journal of Clinical Anesthesia in 2017, where they included 19 RCTs, and they found that dexmedetomidine reduced various neuroexcitatory markers such as tumor necrosis factor alpha, interleukin-6, serum 100 beta, and the neuron-specific endolase, and so on, with significance. In response to stress reaction, dexmedetomidine also attenuated the stress response and of mean arterial pressure, heart rate, and intracranial pressure. There was again a very recent trial, a meta-analysis on dexmedetomidine, which included 26 RCTs, almost giving the same result. Bringing down the neuroexcitatory markers, at the same time clinically reducing the incidence of postoperative cognitive dysfunction and improving the mini mental state examinations on the postoperative day after surgery. as far as other strokes are concerned, because the period of acute ischemic stroke is so very drastic and fast enough that neuroprotective drugs are not have been not capable enough to generate good evidence. But one area of interest is aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage, where cerebral ischemia usually occurs in a very delayed time frame, allowing patients to be enrolled in the drug before the start of the cerebral ischemia. So this was again a meta-analysis published in 2011, which included 8 RCTs, almost about 1500 patients, which showed that nimodipine improved clinical outcomes. And the journey of nimodipine started right from the study by J.D. Picard in 1989, the British aneurysm trial, and then it has now become a standard AHA and ASA class 1 evidence to be used in aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage. This is again a very recent, this year published meta-analysis on perioperative nimodipine to improve cranial nerve functions. And this has been tried in vestibular schwannoma surgeries, where it has been shown that nimodipine significantly increases the odds of cranial nerve recovery after the surgery, and nimodipine was also effective for cochlear nerve improvement after the surgery. So the question is again, yes, has the bedside practice been very well replicated to bedside? The answer is no. There is still lack of convincing evidence as far as neuroprotective agents applied into clinical practice. It's because of the variability in drug selection, dosing timing, length of administration, type of surgery, and type and timing of the neurocognitive testing. Moreover, in animal studies, neurological outcome is usually based on fairly simple tasks, wherein in humans, neurocognitive testing evolves complex neuronal functions and tasks. So what is more important right now and way ahead is the control of the homeostatic factors, which is again very important. That is what we should take care of, is to take care of mean arterial pressure, the optimization of the cerebral perfusion pressure, bring down the ICP in case of neurological injuries, maintain adequate oxygenation and ventilation, glucose, hemoglobin, prevent and treat seizures, normovolemia, temperature, positioning. So these are all the homeostatic factors which should again be brought to as much as physiological values. As part as surgical factors are concerned, decrease surgical tissue injury, limit the ischemia time, and provide measures to reduce embolic load reduction. So this was a very comprehensive guidelines published in 2020, where the SNAC Society published guidelines for prevention of stroke after non-cardiac and non-neurological surgery. I'll just highlight the important points out here because these are important. Preoperatively, they have suggested for identification of the risk factors of post-operative stroke and communicating it to the all the stakeholders. Consider delaying elective surgical cases for at least 9 months after a prior stroke. Avoid initiating beta blocker therapy in the immediate preoperative setting. However, if a patient is already in beta blocker, continue the same. Intraoperatively, anesthetic technique doesn't change much of the outcome. Both TEVA and elational anesthetics have equivocal outcome. Nitrous oxide appears to be safe across wide range of surgical populations. As far as blood pressure, they have not provided a threshold, but what they have recommended is do not allow a prolonged period of hypotension. The duration of hypotension allowed is much more than the actual value of hypotension. For surgery in the beach chair position, blood pressure management should be performed on the non-operative arm, and consideration should be given to the blood pressure gradient between the brachial artery and the brain. And induced hypotension, whenever being considered, should be considered considering all the factors and the risk. Respiratory physiology, maintain normocapnia. For hemorrhage and blood transfusion, they have provided a transfusion trigger of 9 g/dL of hemoglobin to reduce the incidence of post-operative strokes. Glycemic management between 130 to 180 is fairly good enough. Hyperglycemia should be treated with insulin infusions, and hypoglycemia should be avoided. Intraoperative beta blockade, again, a few studies have shown that metoprolol increases the incidence of perioperative stroke, so they have suggested to go for an alternative beta blocker. what they have, there are certain strategies for the post-operative period, but that again comes as a neuro-rescue technique rather than a neuroprotective technique. So I won't go into details. I would request the residents to kindly go through these guidelines. These are very well delineated in the guidelines. Novel neuroprotective therapies like gene therapy have been tried in experimental models to be still replicated in humans. Extracorporeal methods of glutamate reduction and metabolic suppression theory suppressions by infusion of sodium lactate as well as other drugs like acetyl-L-carnitine. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Ankur. And we'll now move to the question answer session. There's a question from Dr. Muralidhar Kanchi to Dr. Manish Kohli that what is the role of NIRS in neuroprotection? Dr. Kohli?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Muralidhar Kanchi has a question for you in the chat box. What is the role of NIRS in neuromonitoring?
So NIRS, practically, it measures the oxygen level in a particular tissue. So, but my topic is practically neurophysiological monitoring. But if we talk in terms of the neuromonitoring, the NIRS per se, I'll say, has a limited role. It's a very good thing to monitor the oxygen levels in a particular area of brain. But suppose if the electrodes, the NIRS electrodes, they are attached in the frontal area, but the area which is at risk is the parietal or the posterior cerebellar area, then it has no role per se, you know. And secondarily, if we talk in terms of the periphery muscles, then if there is any oxygenation hampering mechanism that are going on in the peripheral muscles or something, then maybe NIRS has a role, but not otherwise. NIRS may have a role if we apply directly the probe over the brain at the area which is at risk. Yeah. But again, the data or the studies which has been done till date, they are not concrete or they are not very specific that it can be done. The sensitivity and the specificity of NIRS is not that adequately established.
So right. Dr. Muralidhar, if does that answer your question? But let me add that cerebral oximetry as a part of NIRS is useful in different other kinds of surgery, like in carotid endarterectomy and sitting neurosurgery. So it's a good non-invasive monitor of the brain. But as Dr. Kohli said, probably not in the kyphoscoliosis, which he spoke about, he had restricted himself only to, I think, monitoring of SSCP, MEP and the others.
Yeah.
There's another question from Dr. Muralidhar Kanchi.
Dr. Matero, can I just pitch in?
Yes, sir.
About NIRS, a lot of studies are going on using NIRS and the Doppler for the autoregulation following head injury, stroke, and other things. Of course, NIRS has become very popular in the cardiac setup, particularly for the cardiac anesthesiologist. And it is slowly gaining popularity in neuroanesthesia. Thank you.
A question from Dr. Muralidhar Kanchi to Ankur Khandelwal. He says, why do you have to wait for 9 months after a stroke for a surgery?
Thank you, sir, for the question. What the reason that has been cited in the guidelines is that they would actually wait for the cerebral autoregulation to return back to its near normal state. Usually before 9 months after a stroke, the cerebral autoregulation is usually not well recovered. That is how the rough period has been suggested to be 9 months, where near about cerebral autoregulation will be restored and cerebrodynamics will again be restored. That is the reason that has been cited.
How do you adapt that into your own practice, Ankur?
Sir, we usually wait for 6 months. At least for 6 months. 9 months, I was not very sure of till I went through the guidelines. But again, yes, till 6 months, we usually wait after the previous stroke.
It'll also depend upon the urgency of the surgery.
Yes,
correct.
Correct, sir.
Any other questions? I hand over to the other moderators. Or if the moderators have a question to ask or share some experience, Dr. Mishra?
I would like to, Dr. Kohli to clarify as to when neurophysiological monitoring may not be that well indicated in which kind of spine surgeries. Sir, it is not indicated at all.
Sir, we have experience of many cases. Myelopathy is the main thing. The spinal myelopathy or the cervical myelopathy or the peripheral myelopathy. In these cases, what we have seen is even if the patient muscle power is 3x5 or 4x5 or 2x5, but when we apply our motor evoked potential monitor, we are not able to elicit any response. How many voltages, manipulations in the monitor that we have done? In certain neuromuscular diseases, we are not able to get an adequate motor evoked potential responses. And on contrary to it, we also tried our SSCP monitoring in these patients, but we are not able to do it. Then there is a probe which elicits the D wave or the I wave. So maybe it may help.
Thank you so much.
There's a question from Dr. Ashish. Are there any special considerations in COVID patients with stroke or CVA considering the hypoxia? Ankur?
Sir, in patients with previous history of COVID, and what we have adopted in our institute is that we always go for the entire checkup of all the systems. Especially we do nowadays routine DVT screening for all the patients, and we do a carotid Doppler in patients who had moderate to severe COVID disease and now coming for any elective surgeries. So we do thrombus and also we do echocardiograph. So these are the three more investigations which we have added in patients with previous history of moderate to severe COVID disease, especially patients who have been subjected to steroids. So these are the three new additions. Patients who, number one, these patients, if they are on antiplatelets or anticoagulants, then the risk-benefit ratio has to be calculated. Definitely, if it's an elective surgery, we stop considering. These patients are on NOACs most of the time. So we stop NOACs 3 days prior to the surgery. And if the planned surgery is of low or moderate in nature, we do not breach the NOACs. However, if the patient had been on warfarin, we stop warfarin at least 5 days prior to surgery and try bridging the warfarin with low molecular weight heparin and consider stopping low molecular weight heparin 24 hours prior to surgery and restarting it again as after 24 hours or 48 hours, depending upon the surgical hemostasis and conditions.
Okay. There are two questions from Dr. Muthu. The first is to Dr. Ankur Luthra. Is mucormycosis communicable? And if so, what precautions should be taken? And the second question is ketamine in low dose neuroprotective? That goes also to Khandelwal.
Yes, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yes.
Yeah, sir. Actually, regarding mucormycosis question, thank you for the question. It's communicable in the sense that it's not that, see, mucor spores are present everywhere. They are ubiquitous in nature. They are present in our nasal mucosa. They're present in all sorts of articles, objects around us. But what predisposes to mucormycosis is the reduced level of immunity, which occurs post-COVID, post-diabetic ketoacidosis or post-renal transplants, immunosuppressive therapy, HIV, AIDS, etc., which I told the risk factors. So if you have such kind of factors, this mucor can become florid because it requires things like glucose, like increased ferritin, like increased low immunity, because otherwise immunity and neutrophils are going to kill the whatever mucor if it starts growing. But if the patient's immunity is suppressed per se, then yes, this mucor spreads like anything. It is not that from one patient to another, but if he has risk factors, they have to be very, very careful, especially in the post-COVID era, because multiple patients, because COVID itself causes the second strain of the COVID, which has caused the second wave, is itself a very immunosuppressive virus. Plus the amount of therapy that we have given, this indiscriminate use of steroids, etc., have also led on to this mucormycosis. So then you have to be very, very careful. And then as early as diagnosis, because the signs and symptoms start appearing very quickly. So you have to diagnose it early and start on antifungal treatment if you have risk factors. Otherwise, there is no requirement. Your immunity will very well fight with the mucor. Thank you very much.
There's a question from Dr. Shashank Pandey. I think it is to Dr. Goraksha. How will you manage if the patient is hyperventilating and if there is any sudden movement?
If you have to see if the patient, thank you for the question. The hyperventilating, as you see why the patient is hyperventilating, it is usually because the patient is very anxious or has some pain. So please communicate with the patient, talk to the patient, reassure the patient, and you can give a bit of sedation if that is the reason for it. So that's usually the cause of hyperventilation. And about sudden movements, pre-op counseling does help here. You have to explain to the patient the procedure. And every time you keep talking to the patient, tell them if you have a problem, let us know, talk to us, please do not move. And luckily for us, all these surgeries are done when the head is pinned. So surgical site will not, may not be disturbed, but because the patient is moving suddenly, there can be some injury due to the pins. So you have to keep explaining to the patient. The only thing is communication, open communication, keep talking to the patient. That's the best thing to do. And if you're giving any conscious sedation, make sure that you don't deepen the pain too much, because if the patient suddenly wakes up from deep anesthesia, the patient may not know what is happening. And that is the time when these sudden movements occur. So maintain a lighter plane of anesthesia just when the patient is just about asleep, but not too deep. I think that is the best way to go about it. Thank you.
There's a question from Dr. Muthu to Dr. Ankur Khandelwal. Is ketamine in low doses neuroprotective?
Thank you again, sir, for the question. As I mentioned in my presentation, the review by Frederick Bilotta et al. In 2013, where they had included ketamine as a neuroprotectant, and they didn't find any evidence of ketamine as a neuroprotectant. But again, the recent evidence as of 2021, we have substantial evidence. Number one, ketamine does not increase ICP in both traumatic neurological illness as well as non-traumatic neurological illness, as far as other homeostatic mechanisms are being taken into consideration. Number two, ketamine has a great welcome comeback as far as refractory status epilepticus and super refractory status epilepticus are concerned. And but the important, if we go through the literature, there are three recent or four reviews which have suggested that ketamine should be initiated in a very early period of refractory and super refractory status epilepticus before any substantial brain damage has occurred, rather than starting it in a late phase. So this NMDA receptor antagonist property is basically a neuroprotective property that has now brought ketamine into limelight, considering refractory and super refractory status epilepticus. Yes, but the clear demarcation between low dose and high dose is still to be known. Yes, in future, we might get some good meta-analysis and systematic reviews on ketamine as a neuroprotective agent in humans.
Thank you. I think Dr. Ankur Luthra has written a review on ketamine. I think it's much maligned. And now from a 4, ketamine is soon actually can be a close friend in the future.
Dr. Montero?
Yes.
I want to comment, or rather give very appreciation to Dr. Shweta when she talked of putting a label of awake patient outside the operating room at the gate, as well as inside the operating room somewhere at a prominent place. Because many times we are not accustomed to keep quiet, and we inadvertently speak some words here and there, and some noises could be controlled and could be, you know, when we know that patient is awake, we should take care of those small irritants. And of course, counseling, prior counseling especially is very important, very, very important in awake patient. Prior counseling, patient should know what is going to come. That's important. Of course, communication, yes, I see that very well. Thank you so much, Dr. Shwetal, for putting label of awake patient, because I have gone to many theaters where awakes are done, but nobody puts it. And that always creates problem to the patient. As a patient, you realize how big problem it is when you are not told as what's going to happen and then everyone is talking here and they're moving around. Students are, you know, and it's not noisy. So thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
I hand over to Dr. Jayashree Sood, ma'am.
Yes.
To take over. And
Thank you very much. And I'd request Dr. Baljeet to give the concluding remarks. Thanks a lot from my side. Dr. Baljeet?
Yeah, I'm there.
Yes,
good evening,
please.
After an excellent webinar, I think it's time. Yeah. Hello.
Yes, we can hear you, Baljeet.
Yeah. After an excellent webinar, we come to the end of this session. Well, friends, not before the Indian College of Anesthesiologists expresses its gratitude to all the moderators as well as the speakers. To start with, Dr. Harihara Dash, a pioneering figure in the name of neuroanesthesia, rather the founder of neuroanesthesia in India. He remains the Bhisham Pitama, I must say that, when it comes to neuroanesthesia. Big name is Dr. L.D. Mishra, another very senior person who's been associated with neuroanesthesia for a long time. And then Dr. Joseph Mentero and Dr. Krishna Bhutani, again, big names. Dr. Krishna Bhutani is coming up as a neuroanesthesia of repute, and Dr. Joseph Mentero himself is a very well-established neuroanesthetist. So thanks all the moderators for an excellent moderation. And the speakers, Dr. Shwetal spoke on craniotomy, awake craniotomy, and Dr. Manish Kohli spoke on intraoperative monitoring in the complex spine surgery. Dr. Smith Kalra spoke on optic nerve sheath diameter and its applications in the various fields. And Dr. Ankur Lutra on rhino-orbital cerebral mucormycosis, and Dr. Ankur Khandelwal spoke on neuroprotective strategies. Well, all these lectures were of very high academic order, and I'm sure it must have inspired a lot of youngsters to take up this and set their goals with regard to neuroanesthesia in their own careers. Well, friends, thanks to all the participants as well. And, on behalf of Indian College, once again, I thank each and everyone who participated, who, whether as a faculty or as a speaker or as a very patient listener. Thank you so much and good night.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. Sir. Thanks a lot. You really had a very nice webinar. Sir. Thank you. And thanks, Rakesh.
Thanks, Dr. Baljeet.
Link the webinar to all of us. Thank you very
much. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dash, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you,
sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.